Good afternoon. Late afternoon. Welcome to a very exciting new year to all of you. The year is already old, 2013, but for us, this is an annual event, and we're delighted to see all of our supporters of this course that started many, many years ago and continues to grow. My name is Ogunstein, and I am a professor in the program in public health and a chair of the department there. But my role here today is course director, but there are many of us, and my introduction is based on me being appointed as the instructor of record for the courses that are represented here today. There are two courses, the undergraduate version, Public Health 91, as started last year as a continuation of a program that evolved out of the School of Biological Sciences and the School of Medicine and the Office of Equal Opportunity. Public Health joined last year, and this year we are introducing a graduate version of the course, and it's Public Health 250, entitled Health Status and Care Disparities. In a few minutes, you will meet all of the people who have worked very hard in the background to bring you this course, which is always exciting, motivating a lot of students to learn more about disparities in medicine and public health and in health services delivery. These disparities are meant to provoke you. So we expect this to be an interactive class. Many of you also benefit from the healthcare systems that we'll be talking about. Many of you have relatives, friends, family members, colleagues who may have experienced some of the issues that will be raised in class throughout the quarter. We respect confidentiality of all records, but we also want you to be able to share your experiences among yourselves and with us so that we can enrich the class. The other new thing we are starting this year is that we're videotaping the presentations. And this means that if you are leaving your seat, typing on your computer, or you have a coughing fit or sneezing fit, try to do those things discreetly and as quietly as possible, if that's ever possible. The sound carries, it's a very large auditorium with very good acoustics. I just checked the enrollment. We have 90 students in the undergraduate course, and we have 8 students in the graduate course. In the next few minutes, we'll be talking to you a little bit more about the requirements for those courses and the expectations that all of the coordinators and the directors and the speakers have for your participation in the course. Of course, you all want to get A's, but really the goal is to make sure that this is a learning experience for everyone that will be with you many, many years after you leave the degree program that you're in. So before we proceed, I always go through those statistics and reason why we're here. Because sometimes people are in the wrong room, they think they're in a course that's not being offered at that time and place, or they have other questions. Some of you may not have enrolled yet, thinking you would come today and figure out what this is all about. Do we have any questions so far? No? Okay. You do? No? Okay. So as I mentioned, this is a collaboration between the Office of Equal Opportunity and Diversity, the School of Medicine, the Office of Diversity and Community Engagement within that school, and the Program in Medical Education for the Latino Community, which is popularly known as Primary C, and the UC Online Program in Public Health, which I represent. This is a very rich legacy that we're following. And I wanted to make sure that you all are familiar with some of the history of the program. So this is a new website that you can easily click on to go to the, sorry, that's not active, but if you click on that website, it takes you to the Diversity in Medicine website with an essay on the history of this program, which is more than 10 years old. We credit the Office of Equal Opportunity and Diversity and the leadership there for really bringing this innovative program to our campus and engaging students and community members. In the interest of time, I'd like to explore that, and maybe in subsequent sessions, we'll be asking you a little bit more about what you learned at that website and how we can make it even more informative. You will meet all of the course directors, and I took the liberty to take their images from their respective websites because if they know that it's there and they haven't objected, that means it's free game. Dr. Martha Sosa-Johnson directs that faculty, the Office of Diversity and Community Engagement in the School of Medicine. Preni, popularly known as Preni, I like to say his name, Sanani Koni. If I butcher that, please forgive me. He's been at UCI a very long time, directing the Diversity Relations and Educational Programs for the Office of Equal Opportunity and Diversity. And Jose Rea, Administrative Director, Co-Director, I saw on the website of the Program in Medical Education for Latino Communities in the School of Medicine, and myself. So these are the four directors. As you can see, we span broad areas of our campus and with a lot of experience in teaching and research, practice, and mentoring students. One of the unique features of this program is that we also engage students. And I'm going to not go beyond this. I think our plan is to have the directors say a little bit about themselves, and then we have a very special program, because some of you are aware, but maybe not all of you, that this is a very highly engaging program for students. And we have a set of students that we call coordinators who've been working very hard year-round, actually, to align the speakers, to nominate, to follow up, and to make sure that this presentation, the presentations that we'll have this quarter will be excellent learning opportunities for all of us. And the coordinators always appoint a leader amongst themselves, and for this quarter, it's Stephanie Hamel, and I believe she will come up and maybe introduce the course directors to say something. Okay, thank you.
Hi, my name is Stephanie Hamel. I'm, as Deli mentioned, I'm one of the lead coordinators for this this quarter. Jose Flores is also one of the lead coordinators, and together we've worked with 10 other coordinators to run create this course. And so it's entirely student-run, and we all decide the lecture topics during the course of the year. And then we work together with the speakers to tailor each of the lectures to fit this course. And we also work with our four directors, which we're very honored to work with on a regular basis. And so I'd like to introduce our directors to come up and say a few words about the course. So then we can begin with Jose Rea, who is the, as Deli mentioned again, is the director of Prime LC. So Jose Rea.
So hello everybody, happy new year, even though it's like Deli said, it's a couple weeks old already. I'm Jose Rea. I've been at UCI for a very long time. I'm looking at your faces, and you guys look younger and younger every year. And so I got here way before many of you guys were born, 1984. I was a very non-traditional undergrad coming from East LA Community College. And I did, at that time, that was when the UC didn't have budget restrictions and so many other limitations. So students were freer to wander around different majors and different minors. So I took two majors and two minors, and 300 and some units later, I graduated from from UCI. I never left UCI. I was employed at the School of Biological Sciences. And managing and administering research grants from NIH and NSF, dealing primarily with women and underrepresented minorities in the sciences. And then the opportunity came to come to the medical school when they were planning the very early planning phases for the Prime LC program. For those of you who have not heard about the Prime programs, it is a specialized training MDs with masters, and the goal is to train physicians to address the needs of underserved populations in the state of California. The Prime programs are available at all the five, well now six medical schools in the University of California, with exception of UC Riverside, who is recruiting its first class. But the entire curriculum for UC Riverside, I understand, is geared towards underserved communities in the Inland Empire. So that this is a very innovative program that began at UC Irvine. Actually, we were the first program that was planned and implemented. And it's good to see some of the Prime LC students and medical students here in the audience. And we are recruiting our 10th cohort. And if you're interested in medicine, I will encourage you to look a little bit more into the Prime programs. And you know, most of them added an additional year, but also it's a pretty innovative curriculum in terms of dedicating your career in medicine to the service of the underserved. So if you have an opportunity to explore Prime LC, or if you have any questions, there's some students in the audience. Can I see the hands of the Prime LC students? If you just look around, there's a few of them. Please ask them questions about medical school, Prime LC program, and also you know, explore the Prime programs who try to address the healthcare access and the healthcare needs of racial and ethnic minorities, whether also rural and urban, inner city populations up and down the state. Okay. So thank you, and I'm looking forward to working with you, and feel free to contact me or just reach out for anything that has to do with medical school education. Thank you.
Thank you, Jose. Next up, we'll introduce Dr. Martha Sosa-Johnson. She'll come up here and say a few words about herself as well.
so glad to be here and to welcome you all in this great beginning for a whole new year for us. And yes, I'm indeed the Assistant Dean for Diversity and Community Engagement at the School of Medicine, and I'm also an Associate Professor of Clinical Medicine and Internal Medicine. But of course, my most important role is mom, and that was my 7-year-old saying, "Mom, what are we having for dinner?" And so I apologize for that phone call, I know. But anyways, I started here with UCI back in 1999, and I had the wonderful opportunity to be hired to work at the one of the federally qualified health centers. And we forget that UCI has two of those, and one of them is in Anaheim, and the other one is in Santa Ana. And Santa Ana's a lot more, it's bigger, and it's been around for a little bit longer, so we tend to remember that or hear about that a little bit more. But working at a federally qualified health center means that we take care of populations that come with many needs. And I enjoyed being there because it allowed me to provide services to all those that needed it. And you become very creative in terms of finding solutions for the problems that your patients bring with you. And it also forces you to rely on those skills that perhaps you haven't done since medical school, but you know how to do. Because if you don't do it, your patient will not get it done. And so I'm very, taking care of underserved populations is something that resonates very clearly with me, and it's, I think, a great importance. And hopefully this course will give you a bigger breadth of all the other different groups that we focus on and that we hope that you will also learn from as well. And as part of this new role, it was in 2009 when I accepted the challenge of being the Assistant Dean for Diversity and Community Engagement. And it's a role that I really feel has really allowed me to really grow in my personal and professional development here at the school, and primarily gives me opportunities to work with colleagues such as the ones here with my other co-directors and this incredible group of student coordinators that really worked hard to put this course together, and allows me to work, of course, with an amazing group of medical students at the School of Medicine. So I offer that invitation to anyone out there who wants to talk about what is it about being a medical student, why do I want to be an internal medicine physician, what gives me joy and pleasure in that role that I still have, thankfully, after about 20 years of practicing medicine. So by all means, call me, email me, stop me at the end of course, and if you're going to come talk to me, we'll have coffee at Cafe Med, and we can just find out what your aspirations and any ways that we can help you get there. So thank you very much, and welcome.
Fourth director, but definitely not the least important, chronics and outcomes.
Hello, everyone. I'm really excited to be here this evening. If I'm more excited than this, I'll jump off my skin. Many, many years ago, like 15, two post-bac students actually approached me and said, "You know, as we scan through all the medical schools, both in California, coast to coast United States, we could not find any program that actually addresses healthcare disparities or diversity in medicine. Stanford at that time, 15 years ago, had a semblance of a program, but it's not a full-fledged program. Can we do something about it?" The excitement that I have then, 15 years ago, and tonight is this. This program become a full-fledged program because of students. It's student initiatives, student-initiated program, and I would love to invite each and every one of you to keep that in mind, that, hey, if I want to change the world, here's a program that maybe I can get involved and do something. I'm going to go and talk to all these important people called directors of the program, and maybe that can help me and do something, okay? So come and talk to each and every one of us. As a matter of fact, Dr. Sosa-Johnson invited you to coffee. She never did. She never asked me for a cup of coffee. So she's nicer to you than she is to us. So please take advantage of that, okay? So keep that in mind. As a matter of fact, it started with students. Directors are just behind the scene helping with whatever students were looking ahead for themselves. When I become a physician, what do I need to know? What would happen then? What would life be like? How do I prepare myself from now on to the day that I become a physician and be as competent culturally and otherwise as possible. So with that spirit, I would like to ask you continue to help us to improve this program. For example, only 2 years ago, until a person by the name of Vivian, she's over here, over there, raise your hand. One of the coordinators said, how come in this whole history of 15 years, you never addressed veterans' health care? Good point. Why don't we address veterans' health care? So we added that because somebody said it's important. Okay? So point number one. Point number two, we created this program to allow everyone to participate, and we want to encourage and continue to encourage you to engage in the whole program, not just to sit in here and tell me what's going on and whatever not. Be engaged. The more you get involved, the more you put in, the more you take out as well. Okay, so be engaged with us. Again, it's student-managed, student-run program. There are 12 of them this year. So we set the program in such a way that we invite the whole campus, the medical center, the community to come here as well. I have a few friends in here who are not UCI students. He's already a professor at UCLA, but he's here because there's no such program at UCLA where he's at. And so you can invite your friends, your boyfriends, your girlfriends, your significant others, your mother, everyone interested in coming in here. We designed it in such a way. If you're interested in any of the programs, by all means, you can invite your friends to come and sit in. Okay? We set it up that way. Point number three, last but not least, again, because it's student-run, I would like you to keep an eye on all the students, coordinators here, starting with the two leaders behind me here. They are really, we trust them with our lives, literally. And they manage the class, they manage each other, they manage each of the speakers. And again, each of the speakers coming to speak to this program is not paid. They may be driving from Los Angeles, they may be driving from San Diego, just to be here with you from 5 to 7 o'clock. And many of them are so generous, they stay after class until 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 o'clock at night. And so do take advantage of that, but be sensitive to their need and be respectful. That's all I'm asking you. So only three things, okay? I wanted to continue to see this program as student-run, student-managed, student initiative, to get this program getting better and better and so forth. Point number two, by all means, invite whoever you think would be interested in the program. And point number three, I would like to invite some of you to join us as being part of the coordinators for next year or the following year. Okay? Thank you for being here. I know, they make me work harder than the rest of the other directors. All right, the next portion of the program is something that my colleagues and I throughout the whole system, part of being the director of diversity, my colleagues out of 10 other campuses plus the lab, we meet together once a quarter and we exchange materials, best practices, what works on your campus, what doesn't work, do you have the newest thing that actually helps students or help faculty or help staff and whatever not. So there is a very short videotape that we all use that we found very, very helpful to give you an idea what are we talking about when we talk about diversity in medicine. The title of the videotape is Beyond the Vital Signs. Okay, that's the title of the videotape. And I am asking you to pay attention because it's almost exactly what's going on in the middle of Wall Street in a very, very, very busy day. In this case, it's in a hospital setting. The nurses are going to go from one patient to the other. The special need of this patient go to that special need of that person. And for you to observe what happened. What is the dynamic between a white a nurse, for example, and a black patient, Asian patient, the aging patients, or whatever not, and how do they react to the scene at the hospital, okay? Again, is beyond the vital signs is probably 15 minutes or so. Okay, thank you.
So I've called for an interpreter.
Okay, thanks. How you doing there? We'll just take that gown off.
Quật sư tá sư và nhầm cho ai chui ai chia. Quật sư và nhầm vô mới cho nhau cái chia.
How are you doing today? I'm Richard, I'm from the lab, and I'm going to be drawing some blood for testing.
No, I don't want any tests.
Ah, it'll just be a little pinch, I'm very good at this.
I said no.
Mrs. Humphreys, we need to test your blood. That way we can find out how to help you.
You can't help me.
Aguántate un poquito más.
Te estás promediando.
María, la enfermera. Ya, viejito, ya.
You don't have to keep pressing that. The first time you hit it, the light stays on. Oh, he says he's in pain. I understand, but I increased his pain medication when you called me 10 minutes ago.
You must be able to do something more.
You just need to give the medication a little time to work.
Something is wrong. I can feel it.
Three patients presenting with diverse problems and diverse cultural backgrounds. Their outcomes will depend not only on the medical expertise of their healthcare providers, but also on the healthcare provider's sensitivity, understanding, and responses to that diversity. Healthcare providers would consciously discriminate against patients on the basis of gender, race, disability, or cultural background. But avoiding overt discrimination isn't enough. You also have to become familiar with the culturally influenced beliefs and practices of diverse populations and respond to them appropriately.
Now, how do you know that we can't help you, Mrs. Humphreys? You haven't given us the chance.
Doesn't matter what you do.
You said that you've had these dizzy spells before, right?
Yes, last month. Everything turned black, and when I woke up, I was on the floor.
Okay, and your blood pressure's a little high? You've been having headaches?
Sometimes I do, yes.
There could be something serious going on, Mrs. Humphreys. Something that's important for us to treat. You need to let us find out what it is so we can help you.
I'm in God's hands. If he wills it, I'll get better. If he doesn't, there's nothing you can do to change it.
Well, maybe we could do something to make it look.
When a patient holds specific religious or cultural beliefs, it may be useless to appeal to them from a medical perspective. What you see as common sense may not be the best way to reach them.
Make yourself comfortable, okay? We'll be back.
you feeling, Mr. Saunders?
Okay. Not too bad.
Do you need anything?
No, I'm all right.
Looks good. Is he still feeling pain?
Yeah, no, I want to.
It's still the same as before. He can't bear it.
Should be working by now. Let's give the medication just a few more minutes and I'll check back with you.
Dice que le demos un poquito más de tiempo a la medicina y ahorita regresa.
Mr. Lopez giving you a hard time? No offense. I mean, I know the guy's just had a tumor resection, but you Hispanics don't exactly grin and bear it.
No, we're expressive. We feel good, we sing, we're in pain, we cry.
In general, some ethnic or cultural groups are more expressive about pain than others. But that can vary a great deal from individual to individual. Dismissing a patient's complaints because of ethnic stereotyping can mean ignoring important symptoms and denying appropriate care.
Well, it's not just Latinos. Last month, I had this room with a Greek in one bed and a Saudi in the other. They ran me ragged.
All patients should be Asian or British. They die before they ring the call button.
His tip is 101.6. His BP is 100 over 70. Non-productive cough and those welts are only on his chest.
Anyone on that interpreter?
They said he's on his way.
This is clearly not a rash. You know, these look like bruises to me.
They look familiar. Those marks are definitely from coining.
Coining?
They rub the skin with a coin until it raises welts.
Many cultures have beliefs and practices with regard to illness that are at odds with Western medicine. It's important to be familiar with the ones practiced by the groups you serve.
Why would they do something like that?
To draw illness out from the body. There's a similar practice called cupping, where they place a heated cup or glass on the skin. It's pretty widespread through Asia and Latin America.
Mm, really?
I just couldn't buy Axan for the respiratory infection.
And what about the welts? Do you want me to call Child Protective Services?
No, let's wait for the translator. I want to make sure we have our facts straight.
Yes, Richard. This is Mrs. Dominguez. She said she and her baby were here yesterday visiting a patient and you spoke to her in the hallway?
Could be.
Do you remember complimenting her baby?
Yes. I think I saw them when we were next to the elevator and I told her how cute her baby was. Why?
Well, it seems you gave her baby the evil eye.
The what?
When you compliment a baby without touching him, you can give him the evil eye and make him sick.
What are you talking about?
Go over to her and touch her baby. That removes the curse.
This is a gag, right?
Just do it, please.
Hi. It's nice to see you again.
Su bebé va a estar bien ahora.
Gracias.
Muchas gracias. No tengo palabras para agradecerle.
Que tenga buen día.
Igualmente.
The evil eye.
Mm-hmm.
You believe in that nonsense?
Well, it doesn't matter what I believe. What matters is that she believes it. And she would have worried herself sick over her baby if we had not eased her mind about the evil eye. She would have taken her to a curandera.
A what?
A spiritual healer.
It's just superstition.
Hey, Reacher. We're not here to judge people's beliefs. We're here to give them medical care, right?
See
you. Don't forget you're paying for lunch.
She won't let you draw blood. Why not?
She's entrusting herself to God's will.
What about the CAT scan?
Same thing.
Did you explain to her that we can't form a diagnosis without them?
Yes, I tried.
Well, let's have her sign out AMA and I'll discharge her.
Dr. Cashman, she has a BP of 180 over 100 and a history of losing consciousness. She could have diabetes or stroke out.
She's not in imminent enough danger for us to get a court order to override her wishes. She has the right to refuse treatment.
Oh, please, my father is in terrible pain.
What's
please,
wrong?
My father, you must send the doctor, please. He is in terrible pain.
Okay, I'll be right in.
Thank you.
Do you want to call Dr. Henderson?
I suppose so.
explain to them how the pain meds work?
Yeah.
Thanks. Dr. Henderson, it's Kelly Mitchell.
He's always gotten better once I drew out the sickness, but not this time, so I brought him here.
When did you do this?
Yesterday morning.
Okay, thank you, Mrs. Holt. Excuse us.
Look, how can we not call Child Protective Services?
I don't know.
That woman rubbed metal on the child so hard, it raised welts.
All right, look, I'm going to turn this over to CPS.
Wait a minute. If you do that, she'll be afraid to bring him back next time he's sick.
Are you saying she didn't hurt him?
No, she was trying to help him. She believed that coining was the best way.
Wait, hold it. And where do we draw the line? Do we tolerate harmful behaviors just because it's well-intended?
Look, I know it's hard to believe, but there are people in this country who put metal strips around children's teeth and tighten them until the teeth move out of place. I mean, come to think of it, you did that to your son Joey, didn't you?
Joey needs braces. That's completely different.
Not everyone would think so. Some cultures would consider that barbaric. And some kids are forced to wear braces for purely cosmetic reasons. At least this woman was trying to cure her son of an illness.
By rubbing the evil out of his body. That's ignorant superstition.
From our point of view, yes. But she was trying to help him, not punish him.
What do you mean?
Her whole life. Someone gets sick, they rub him with a coin, he gets better.
He would have gotten better anyway.
How can she know that? Maybe she's been witnessing proof positive that her coin treatment works.
Okay. I don't want you to go in there. I want you to...
There are laws that dictate how healthcare practitioners should respond to possible cases of abuse. Check with your own healthcare institution if you are unsure which laws apply to you. However, as much as possible, it's important to view traditional remedies and practices within the context of their culture and to distinguish those that are truly harmful from those that are not.
Lunchtime, Mr. Lee. Enjoy.
No, take this away.
Mrs. Lee, your husband needs to eat. He has to get his strength back.
But this will make him weaker. It's too much yin. He needs a yap food to restore his balance. Here you see? This will give him what he's missing. Balance his chi.
Well, he's not on a restricted diet. Okay. Enjoy your lunch, Mr. Lee.
When there's no real medical reason to oppose traditional practices, it's best to permit them. The psychological comfort they provide can be of great benefit.
Mrs. Humphreys, how are you feeling?
A little tired.
Okay, can I get you something to drink?
No, thank you, not right now.
Mrs. Humphreys, have you thought about letting us help you?
I know you mean well, but there's nothing you can do.
What do you think is wrong?
It's my punishment.
Why would you say that?
I did something once, a long time ago. And now God is judging me. He's taken away my strength to humble me.
Everyone gets sick sometimes. That's why we're here, to help you get better.
I have to show that I repent, beg God's forgiveness. Then if it be His will, He will make me better.
Approaching patients through their own belief systems is often the most effective way to win their trust and cooperation.
Would you like me to call your minister for you? Have him come down and see you? Maybe he could give you some guidance.
Yes. It's Reverend Atwater at First Community Church on Lansing Street.
Okay, I'll call him.
Thank you.
Mrs. Humphreys, I have a form here that says that you've refused medical treatment against our advice. If you sign it, you can leave the hospital without taking the test. But before you do, I was wondering if maybe I could just tell you a little story.
Sure.
Okay. Well, once there was this big flood, and this man, he climbed his way to the top of his house so that he could be on his roof so the water wouldn't get him. And a boat came by, and they said, get on with us. And he said, no, God will save me. And as he stood there, the water rose and rose and rose until he could barely even speak. And he looked up, and there were helicopters going, and they sent down a basket. And he said, no, God will save me. And a little while later, he drowned, and he went to heaven, and he found God, and he said, Lord, why didn't you save me? And God replied, what do you mean? I sent you a boat and a helicopter. Mrs. Humphreys, maybe we are your boat. Maybe God wants to heal you through us.
Maybe I'll talk to my minister before I make my final decision.
Okay.
Here, you hold on to these until then.
I will. And I will go and call Reverend Atwater.
Hasta bien, papi.
Me duele mucho. Que no aguanto.
He says he can't stand the pain.
Por favor, ayúdame.
Please help him.
The incision looks good. How much drainage in the past hour?
Empty 25 cc's of slightly bloody drainage.
He's hemorrhaging. Get a gurney and let Arno know. We'll bring you a depth stat.
Right away. Send a gurney to room 504.
Please tell your father he needs another operation.
Papi, va a necesitar otra operación. Excuse me.
Nurse.
Yes.
What's going on?
Your husband is bleeding inside his stomach. We're going to go in and fix the problem, and then he'll feel much better.
Is that why he was in so much pain?
Yes.
But he was complaining for a long time. Shouldn't you have done something for him sooner?
Treating a diverse patient population is a complex and challenging task, but the basic principles are simple. Learn about the beliefs and practices of the groups you serve. Develop a tolerant, accepting attitude towards points of view that differ from your own. Be familiar with the group without losing sight of the individual, and treat everyone with respect. You'll increase patient cooperation and satisfaction, and reduce stress for them and for you. And that's a prescription that works for everyone.
Ow! You said this wasn't gonna hurt.
Surprise during the video, and I heard some laughter up here as well. So there's always some moments in there resonated with some of you during the video. So I was hoping to open up just the discussion a little bit to see how, if you've had these experiences yourself, or if family members have had it, or how you felt about those vignettes. Did they ring true? Were they over the top? Anybody out there? Yeah.
The pointing practice. I grew up with it, so I thought it was pretty, like, for me, it was commonplace. People, my friends grew up with it, too.
Exactly. And so it's important to know about some of those practices. Like, I like what they said about in the communities and cultures that live around you, particularly as healthcare providers, it's really important to know about some of these practices, so coining being one. And there's another, thank you for sharing that. Anybody else?
Well, besides coining acting, I thought, like, all of those issues were really, like, they're really accurate. I've seen like patients that like from certain cultural groups that like just panic over nothing, and so like the doctors always told me to like remain calm and keep in mind that like certain cultural groups tend to do that more than other groups. So.
Or they're more expressive.
They're more expressive.
Yeah, because because sometimes people will have different cultural belief systems as to how they're able to communicate that pain or the suffering or the distress, which to us might seem a little bit over the top. And others, traditionally don't. But again, that doesn't mean that one does or one's right. It's just your own expressive way. So yes, absolutely. So you remain calm and collected and kind of go through that and try to figure out what's going on with them. I agree.
I think that despite how different cultures are going to respond to maybe their son or their loved ones being sick, I think you can't ignore any type of like warning. Because I've had some personal experiences of that in the hospital. They gave me like 4 grams of steroids, for example, and my blood sugar went up. They didn't know that I was borderline diabetic, and so my blood sugar was 800, and like I had a coma. So, and we told the nurse multiple times like I was sweating, I wasn't feeling well, and the nurses just ignored it. And because my mom was panicking, and she kept telling the nurse like, come like take care of him. And they found out, and basically like it was a lot of trouble because they had to like give me an insulin shock and stuff like that. So like ignoring symptoms, whether they're small or big, whether it's whatever minority it is, it's not okay, in my opinion. As a doctor, I would pay attention to small and big details.
Mm-hmm. And being aware that a change might actually mean something very significant is going on. And I like what you said about having an advocate with you. It's always nice to have that family member who can speak on your behalf if you're not able to. So that's really also very important. Exactly. Exactly. The not stereotyping, to realize that there are, that they're there for a reason, that they're expressing the discomfort for a reason. Yeah.
Yeah, I wanted to talk about the evil eye. I'm Hispanic, so I know what that
means.
My mom thinks like it's happened to me before when I was a baby, but even within Hispanics, they might not know what an evil eye means. Because I have Hispanic friends that, so I could talk to them and they'd be like, I don't know what that is, and they're Hispanic. So keep that in mind too, that not in every culture there is like the same beliefs, even within the same culture.
Right, exactly. And so you might have grown up knowing about that practice, but other individuals may not have. And so again, not generalization or stereotyping that because you're Hispanic, everybody knows about, my empacho or my laide or, or in this case, the evil eye, mal de ojo. All right. Anybody else?
I really enjoy how they emphasize the point about like your psychological health and making sure that your patient feels like at peace with like the treatment, because I've had doctors tell me like, they've asked me like, do you think that there's a reason for this condition happening?
Not even.
And I think one time I said like it was really, really stressed out this quarter, so this happened to me, and I've had like a doctor just brush it off like, but everyone goes through stress, right? And hearing that, like, I feel like your psychological state of mind has a lot to do with how you make, like, decisions that affect your health. Mm-hmm. And if you want your patient to, like, make effective decisions for their health, you're better off, like, giving that, like, psychological state of mind.
And understanding that that is part of health, right? So I'm an internal medicine physician, so I hope that I will never forget that when a patient walks in through my door, I'm taking care of them from head to foot. And that includes psychological concerns that they bring to the table, that if they have confidence in me and trust in me, that they will share with me, because how you are emotionally and psychologically does affect your health and your perception of health. And so that, I'm glad you said that. That's very, very important. And hopefully we never forget that.
Since you practice in the field, one of the things that that I was thinking about was during the video with a patient that refused medical help for religious.
Mrs. Humphreys.
Yes. That doctor that said that they should just get her to sign the paper. Like, was he right or was he wrong? And where do you draw the line with a patient? Because if he spent
you know, more time trying to convince her, like, he could have used that time to be helping another patient. So where do you draw the line?
So my question would be, do you think he talked to her?
Not sure.
No.
The impression I got from the vignette is that he didn't take the time to actually go and talk to her. That's the impression I got. I could be wrong, but that's kind of what I felt. And I'll just share with you really quickly because I liked your question. And it has to do about, you know, how we define cross-cultural care. And in terms of, you know, it's just the ability to communicate effectively and to provide quality care to patients from diverse backgrounds, right? And so it's all about providing, they define as, you know, you're curious, you're empathetic, and you give respect. And that's how we provide cross-cultural care. Well, I've always thought it's really interesting because that very same definition, for me and the way it's defined, you know, these are the core values, curiosity, empathy, respect, you know, which are necessary for providing effective cross-cultural care, are exactly the values that are fundamental to the practice of medicine. So to me, it becomes very easy. I do, what I'm doing every day is the way you should, you know, how we practice medicine, and providing those core values is how we do cross-cultural care. And one of the biggest things about that is that I don't think that physician did, and, you know, another day we can talk about what's called patient-centered care delivery. And one of the biggest concepts in that is it is really exploring patients' belief systems. And what the nurse did very well, the one who spoke to Mrs. Humphreys, is she explored those belief systems. And what was the very first question she asked her when she came back? Do you guys remember that question? That she asked her that got her talking? If you can let us help you. But it was centered a little bit about what do you think may have caused the problem is one of the questions, you know, in terms that you can use to exploring belief system. But I think she asked her, what do you think is going on? You know, what's going on? Why don't you think we can help you? Right? And that opened it up. She had some previous sin or predicament or situation that she felt she was paying penance for right now, right? And that got her opening, and that then allowed the nurse to see that she was religiously grounded and therefore could open up the discussion about the minister and calling him and everything. So, yeah, so it's a tough one with that one in terms of if you can talk to the patient and explore those belief systems, and these are just some of the questions you can use. You know, what do you call the problem? What you know, why do you think it started when it did? Or what do you know about the illness and how does it work? And, you know, what kinds of treatments do you think you should receive or not receive? Or what do you fear most about the sickness? You know, those are all the things. And I will share this with you. I hadn't intended to. But if this isn't the right place to share that, I don't know what other place is. So it will take about 3 or 4 minutes of your time. So I personally had an interaction with a patient about a month ago. And I have to say, in the close to 18 years that I've been practicing medicine, that was one of the most trying and challenging personal experiences that I've had in a long, long time. And it was a patient that came in, and by the very symptoms of being short of breath for about a week, and feeling that she couldn't get around her home, and having had a pain across her chest the day before, across her back, the day before that radiated to her chest, in which she had to take a nitroglycerin to make it go away. And I knew that she had a known history of heart failure, and she had been unable to be consistent with taking her water, her diuretics. I wanted to admit her to the hospital right there. I don't need much more. I'm done. You know, you gotta go. This could be your heart called unstable angina, which you're about ready to have a heart attack. This could be that you're in congestive heart failure. This could be that you had a pulmonary embolus. There's many things it could be. The worst thing about the pain across the back and in her chest, I thought, oh my gosh, maybe it's a thoracic aneurysm. So there's a lot of bad things that it could be. So I asked her to be transported to the emergency room. And she said, no, I'm not going to the emergency room. I don't like your emergency room. They treated me poorly the last time, and I'm not going. So, and I spent about 15 minutes in there trying to convince her. And like any other person, I asked, why don't you want to go? You know, what's the reason? And she gave me all this about the emergency room, et cetera. Well, at about 20 minutes, and this is on a Tuesday when it's mommy day, so I'm done at 12. And I was seeing her at a quarter of 12. So by this time, it's 12:30, and she didn't want to go. Well, at that point, I have to have her sign in against medical advice that I couldn't convince her. So she signed the against medical advice. I went through all the different scenarios that could happen and asked her one more time. She still said no. The paramedics come in because they're the ones that are going to transport her, you know, that I had already called because of her symptoms. So she said no. And then after she signed the against medical advice form, she decompensated in front of me. She started getting very nauseous, very dizzy, and very lightheaded. And that's when I called 911. She's going to go at that point because it's an acute decompensation. I gave her some oxygen, et cetera, et cetera. You know, we supported her. They show up within 10 minutes. They go into the room. I'm stepping up because I'm writing my notes. So I can't, because they're, you know, coming to pick her up, so I got to write my note. And then I hear in the background, "No, I am not going with you." I said, "No, she didn't just do that." "No, I am not going with you." And I heard the, you know, paramedics talking to her for about 10, 12 minutes, and they're assessing her and her vitals and all this, and her oxygenation level was down to 93%. And for those of us who are non-smokers in this county, it should be about 99 or 100, right? So something was wrong. And I heard them say, "Well, you're going to have to sign an against medical advice form." So she signed an against, you know, they're leaving it, and against medical advice, she signed a form for them. And then I hear, because it's down the corner, she says, "Yes, well, tell your doctor that you want to talk to her." And so she signed one out with me. She signed one out with the paramedics. And then she still wanted to talk to me. And in the meantime, I've already given her 2 nitroglycerin. And, you know, we're trying to get her to be stabilized in some way. And so I walk into the room. And I remember distinctly, she stands up and she sits at the end of the table. And she looks at me and she goes, "I am angry at you." And I remember before I walked in, I told myself, "Just let me listen, just let me listen, just let me listen." And so when I walked in, she said that. I go, "Okay, why are you angry?" She goes, "How dare you call the paramedics?" I go, "Well, we have to transport you, and there's another way." She goes, "No." She goes, "Do you know that if you transport me by the paramedics, I'm going to have a $1,000 bill? And that's a deductible, and I don't have that money. Did you know that?" "No, I didn't know it was going to be that high." She goes, "I want you to instead put me in one of those little, you know, buses that take you around the campus, the university hospital. Put me in one of those buses and they can take me to the university too." I go, "It doesn't work that way. You have to go through, you know, paramedics." And she goes, I'm just so mad that you didn't know that that would cost me that much money. I can't do that." She goes, "Why don't you just admit me directly into the observation unit?" I go, "Well, I don't have that ability or capability. Because it doesn't work that way." "Well, the cardiologist did it last time. That's how they got me to be admitted." Anyway, so long point is that she had underlying concerns that I wasn't aware of. And I'm glad I told myself to listen because, you know, we're all human beings, and after all this, there's a certain amount of frustration at your end. And she said to me that that I needed to figure it out because it's those kinds of rules and regulations that I could not overcome that were going to kill her. Because I didn't know how to admit her to the observation unit. Well, obviously, I figured it out, and I was able to get that assistance. But what almost was a learning, big lesson for me that day was that when I asked her, what was the problem? Why did she only want to be admitted to the observation unit? And she said to me that in the observation unit, because she'd done it before, it was a 24-hour stay. And if they found nothing wrong with her, she could go home, and she wouldn't have to pay the hospital deductible. And I have to say, despite practicing medicine as long as I have, I took a deep breath and I had to hold back my tears because I understood that I didn't understand her concerns. Despite, you know, the fact that on that particular day, despite all the things she told me about the emergency, those weren't the real reasons. The real reasons were financial. And we hadn't had time to talk about this. I didn't understand that that was an issue for her, an obstacle for her, that the deductible for the paramedic ambulance or that her being admitted to the hospital and having to pay her part of it, just, I don't have that kind of money. So if you don't find me a solution, I'm going to die because I'm not going to go any other way. So anyway, so it taught me that, yes, I can learn new different things, and I did call the cardiologist, and I did find that I could admit to the observation unit. But he had to agree because he had to call the cardiology fellow and he had to accept my patient. So I learned a new way to get a patient into the emergency room, bring into the hospital. And we admitted her, and at the very end, she looked at me and she goes, "You probably thought I was a real pain today, huh?" And I said, you know what? No, I have to thank you. I now know how to admit someone to the observation unit. And I learned a lot about other questions I need to ask my patients. And I was very, very, very grateful because the next day when I called to find out what had happened, she had actually had massive pulmonary emboli into both lungs. She lived up. So, you know, those variables about exploring belief systems, I don't care how seasoned you are, you know, they're there, they're the undercurrent. They're the things that if you don't take the time to talk to your patients about or even understand that now in the back of my mind, when someone wants to sign an MA, I will be more aware about all those financial variables because for her, she would have preferred to have died than to pay those deductibles. And it seems silly to you and me, but when you don't have it, because I know because she lives in a motel room in Santa Ana by herself, I mean, I know that her living situation, those are the kinds of belief systems that you need to explore with your patients. And so we hope those are the kinds of things we hope you'll get from this course, and you've already seen some of yourself in some of the practices that you know in your own cultures, your own experiences from the communities from which you come, and you can share those with us, and we can all learn from each other, because you know, we continue to learn and continue to get experience from those around us as well. So I thank you for sharing those experiences. Anybody else have anything else that they'd like to share? Because at this point, if not, we'll turn it over to our student coordinators. But anything else from that video? And I thank you for letting me tell you about my patient. That particular, I guess, my blood vice patient. Okay, thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Dr. Sosa-Johnson. Now we want to move on to introducing our coordinators. So there's 12 of us, and there's two lead coordinators, both of us here. And we all worked together since last March, when the course ended last year, to put this course together. So we all collected contact information for speakers. We put the course together. We decided the lecture topics. And so I'm very proud to say that we've done very good work, and we put this course together for all of you to be here today. And so I want to thank everyone, or all the coordinators, as well as the directors, for all their hard work for the last year. As for me, as I introduced myself, my name is Stephanie Hamill. I'm a first year grad student in the program of public health. I'm doing my MPH here, and I just graduated last year with my bachelor's degree in both chemistry and biological sciences. And this course was very important to me when I first took it 2 years ago. I've been with the program for 2 years. And the reason why I think it's very important for all of you to be here today is because it really did open up my eyes and also my mind to so many different perspectives and so many different ideas that I hadn't really considered before, in spite of all the experiences I had in my own life. And so it really changed my mind on in terms of how I viewed health and as well as how I viewed what I wanted to do with my life. And it really, at first I was like, I want to become a medical doctor, I want to go to med school, and that's exactly what I want to do. And when I took this course, it actually changed my mind away from that. And while I realized that medical students and medical doctors have a very important role, I realized that wasn't my role. And that was a very big transition for me personally. And so I hope that while your journey might not be as transitionatory as mine, I hope that you all get as much from this course as I did.
Thanks, Stephanie. I'll introduce myself next. My name is Jose Flores. I'm currently a fifth year here at UC Irvine. I graduated last year with a degree in biological sciences, and I'm back during my gap year while I'm applying to medical school. I'm completing a second degree in philosophy. So, that's me. But I took this course back when I was a second year sophomore. I'd actually just switched my major from computer science to biology. Went in a totally different direction. I thought I wanted to, I actually changed my ideas from being a software engineer to being a doctor. So I was just starting in the bio program, you know, taking the classes, all those lower div ones. So for you guys that are still in there, just hang in there, it gets better. But I wasn't really sure, you know, what I wanted to do in medicine. I sort of just had the idea that I wanted to be a doctor. And so this class came up, I heard about it, I thought it'd be a good way to just get a better insight into, you know, what the healthcare field is like, what sort of issues there are. And I can say, I mean, I think as well as for the other coordinators here, that it was a pretty eye-opening experience, and it really changed my perspective a bit of what it is to be serving patients. especially in a system that isn't like as glamorous as it's always portrayed or seems to be portrayed, that there are real issues to fix, that going forward as a doctor, you will face a lot of different situations. And for myself, it really cemented my commitment to become a primary care doctor. That I decided that's what I wanted to study, that I wanted to be a general practitioner and work with community health and international health. We had some speakers on there that year that spoke about it, and they were really inspiring to me personally and helped me choose a direction of where I wanted to go in medicine. So that's, you know, what it did for me, and obviously I stepped up to be a coordinator for that reason. So again, I hope that it helps you out if, you know, you're deciding what you're going to do, or if you're already going to med school, or if you're already a grad student, or if you already are in med school. It's an experience that hopefully you take something away from this course, and it helps you in whatever you're doing, it's health related or even not. So.
All right. Hello, everybody. Thank you all for being here. Thank you for your interest, and thank you, directors, for that wonderful introduction. I was just so pumped after that. Thank you. You know, what I found so beneficial from this course, and the reason why I decided to apply for a coordinator position, was because I felt that in our training to become healthcare professionals, in our become doctors and nurses, so on and so forth, our education and our training was emphasizing the sciences the most. And no doubt that should take the majority of the time and that should be emphasized, but I felt that that was far from the only thing that went into making a successful doctor, a successful nurse. And I found this class to be offering that other component that is necessary for successful healthcare, as you saw in this video right now, that the education about who your patients are, who are the underserved, why are they underserved, and what factors, what conditions, what non-scientific, non-medical conditions, such as religion, such as culture, such as socioeconomic status, go into health of the patient as well, and that must be accounted for in order to deliver the best healthcare. And you're not going to learn that in your biology classes. You're not going to learn that in your organic chemistry. And I found that to be here. And you know, it really completed my paradigm. It really completed my paradigm of healthcare delivery, where we're not just treating the diseases. You know, we're learning about that from our science classes, but we're also now treating the patients. We're knowing who they are, where they're coming from, and what we can do for them. And you know, I hope that you guys from this class, you can understand why you are choosing to go into medicine, why you are choosing to deal with patients. Who are these patients? And how you can make a difference from that profession. Again, thank you so much for your interest, and I look forward to learning alongside of you as well. Thank you.
So there's a lot of us, so I'll keep this brief. My name is Nayeli Correa. I'm a third year biology major with a minor in Spanish. I took the class last year and I applied to be a coordinator, so now it's gonna be about a year that we've all been working together. And I'm really excited for the course. The lectures are gonna be really interesting. Mine personally is Women's Health with Dr. Hines, and she's a returning speaker from last year. So I know that her lecture is gonna be really good, not just because I'm in charge of it, but she's very entertaining, and her lecture is gonna have a lot of useful information for us to use. And I look forward to getting to know some of you, whoever. We're all available for questions after and just to talk, so feel free to do that after the lecture, but I hope you enjoy the course, and yeah, that's about it.
Hi, I'm Neha Bhatt. I'm a fourth year biological sciences major, and I'm double minoring in women's studies and queer studies. Last year I attended the DIM seminar, and this year I am a course coordinator. My topic for that I will be helping to facilitate is disparities within prison health. The reason why I became interested in diversity in medicine is because I view biology and medicine through a critical social lens, and I take into consideration the various social structures such as race, class, gender, sexuality, and all the rest. And I want to look at how they create various power hierarchies which shape and affect the lives of individuals in our society, especially those that deviate from the norm. Diversity is important to me, especially within medicine, because we need to be able to look at our differences and recognize them in order for us to center our efforts and frameworks around to support and help the most marginalized individuals and communities. And with a informed citizenry, we can promote and provide ethical care to everyone. And that's it.
Hi, so I'm Irene, I'm a second year bio major. And the reason that I guess I'm here as a part of these coordinators is kind of the same reason that you've been hearing a lot, because like I was always like I was just studying like Lewis dot structures and parts of the cell, and it's really hard, or it's really easy to forget like why you're studying all of that, and it's to be able to help people like through medicine. And I think that taking this course kind of opened my eyes to a lot of the different problems that you could run across, and it made me want to work to change those problems and to help other people in more than just treating them. So whether or not you guys want to do medicine, I really hope that you take this course and that you get something out of it. My lecture is going to be in February 6th. It's Dr. Hufford. He's also a returning speaker. He's talking about religion and spirituality in medicine, and he's my favorite speaker from last year, so I really hope you guys enjoy it.
My name is Erin. I'm a third year public health science major, and my speaker is Director Snowden. She's for LGBT. And she was a really inspiring speaker. I got to listen to her last year, and it was just a really great lecture. She's a really great speaker, so I wanted to bring her back this year. And my reason for doing this is basically the same as everyone else's. When I got here, I didn't realize that like you had to treat people differently based on their cultures or religion or background. You know, I just assumed they were all people, and I was only looking at like the medical aspect. So it really just opened my eyes to a lot of things.
Hi, I'm Joanne, and I am a fifth-year psychology, social behavior, and public health policy double major. And my speaker is going to be Dr. Stevens, who's going to be talking about healthcare reform. And she was one of my favorite speakers last year. For me, it's a very personal subject because as a patient for the past 10 years, I've seen the good, the bad, and the very ugly of how our healthcare system works in this country and what could be changed, what could be addressed. Addressing socioeconomic, racial barriers, things like that, that we see all the time. And one of my interests in medicine is relatively new. It's been kind of cropped up over the past 10 years, or the past year. And one of the reasons I was interested in this is, as a patient, I thought I had seen everything over so many years, but I realized I was only seeing it from my perspective and from my doctor's perspective. And from this class, I learned that there's just so many other ways to look at how to treat a patient, what you need to consider when you are treating them. And as much as you might have seen personally, there's so much else out there that you need to consider. So I hope this class helps you guys consider that in your future, too.
Hello, everyone. My name is Christina Sue, and I'm a fourth-year bio major with a minor in religious studies. This is my second year in diversity in medicine, and I've never been more excited to be here. This course has shown me a lot more than just, you know, what you see about medicine on television and whatnot. And it's really opened my eyes to why I want to pursue medicine and healthcare. And it's because of the social justice and the disparities that we see, such as in this video. And it's something that will always be an ongoing effort. And I realized that I really want to be a part of that effort. So I'm really excited for you all to be here. And judging from your responses and your questions about the video, I know that you all are going to take so much away from this lecture or this lecture series. And yeah, so thank you. I'm Vivian, and I'm a first-year medical student, and I was also an anteater, so I went through, and I'm glad to be back here at UCI. And I've been through this program several times, but I really want to share with you a rather ironic lesson that took me a long time to learn. And it was that as the more I know about people's values, their beliefs, and their different behaviors, it was ironic that the more we all seem the same, because in the end, we all want to be successful, we want to be able to provide for our loved ones, whether that's our family or our significant other, our children or extended family and friends. And so also, we all need a little help getting there. So I encourage you to admire and appreciate the diversity around us, but I really challenge you to take from this course how we are all alike and how you can look at a stranger and recognize that they're like your brother or sister. And that's the best. To me, it's not so much science and the medicine, but you just want to treat everyone to the best of your abilities, and that's by recognizing that they're actually very close to you. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. My name is Carrie Duncan. I am a third-year public health and political science major. I originally took this class my freshman year, and it really changed my entire perspective about where I want to go in life. I grew up in a family that is full of healthcare professionals, so I thought I knew everything that there was to know about the healthcare system. I thought, well, there are some issues here and there, but we know what we're doing. After taking this class, I realized that we have a lot of structural problems, and it's very difficult to treat everyone the same, even though everyone deserves it. And it helped me realize where I want to go in life. So it's helped me realize that I want to go into helping the structure and the laws that govern our healthcare system. Because the healthcare system is something that we all deserve and that we all need, it is something that is a core value and something that can bring us all together despite our diverse backgrounds. So I really hope that you guys all enjoy the class and that you also get everything that you can out of it. Thank you.
So this is the last one, I promise. My name is Shruti Chandram. I'm a third year biological sciences major with a potential double major in political science. So this class was the best class I took last year, basically, because it combined two of my most enjoyable interests, basically. What I hope that you guys take from this class and what's most unique about diversity in medicine is we're going to be presenting some incredibly complicated topics to you guys, such as prison health and women's health care. But this is a forum for you guys to have an incredibly nuanced discussion about these topics. So I hope you guys can really, you know, ask questions and feel free to really learn as much as you can, because this is probably one of the few classes that you see that are geared to help you guys and solely for you guys to grow from it. So I hope you guys enjoy, and you know, at any point in time, we're all here, and we're more than happy to address any questions or concerns.
Thank you. So next, we want to invite Dr. Ogunstein back to discuss the individual motivation behind this course.
Thank you, Stephanie and Jose. The student coordinators always make my head swell. I'm so proud of the work that they put into the course. There are multiple meetings. My email box is just overflowing with messages that they shoot back and forth. But also the diversity of interests and motivation that they bring to the course, I think is just enriching. Some have been with the course more than 2 years, for example, and each year there are always new opportunities to learn. And I didn't want to leave it to them. One of the ways we've kept this going is to make sure that we create a program that inspires others to want to continue the trend. This year, as I mentioned earlier, we have a very special set of participants with us. I started at UCI about 25 years ago. And for me, the interest, I did all my degrees in microbiology and subsequently decided that I wanted something more human than bacteria and fungi. So I went into public health and I got another degree in public health while I continued to work here. And so when the opportunity came to do something educational in public health, I was really excited at the chance to at least bring something with my colleagues to the educational system at Auburn. And the Master's in Public Health degree is one of those professional degrees. As you heard, there are so many different career options that require the knowledge that we try to acquire through this course. The Master's in Public Health is the gateway to public health practice. And we focus on population level interventions and prevention. But we have to understand the factors that mediate why disparities persist in populations and how we can translate that information to the point of care when physicians are dealing with individuals. So it's a collaboration. And when we started designing the Master's in Public Health program, we decided that we had to have a track in that addresses this very question of diversity. And so we have a track called Sociocultural Diversity and Health. And initially we were expecting, oh, maybe just the primary systems will come in, but it turned out very quickly to be the largest cohort of students in the MPH program. I also have an appointment in the School of Social Ecology, and for many years we had a doctoral program, PhD training program, in social ecology with emphasis in epidemiology and public health. And all of the issues that we are addressing in this course, they are informational, but believe me, what really solves problems is how we are able to understand, investigate, essentially conduct research. Try things out. What works with this population? What doesn't work with this kind of individual? And how we transform that information out of the research rooms into practice. And that's an extremely important aspect of the kind of research we expect of doctoral students in the social ecology, PhD, epidemiology, and public health. So I heard several students talk about, oh, it's not just the science and the biology and the chemistry. It is about the research, and it doesn't matter what the field that you're investigating. And in your practice, if you bring in this idea of, I don't know everything, I'm going to try to collect information regularly and to use that information to enrich my knowledge system, it will improve the way you practice. We couldn't have asked for a better example than the one that Dr. Sosa-Johnson gave, and thank you for that, because it's learning on the at the moment of care. And that will make you all better researchers and better practitioners. I think by now you already know a little bit about the goals of the course. We have put together a website through EEE. I'm sure you've all been through. The syllabi are online. The course is built around the experts who come to share their knowledge with us. The people who have their fingertips right on the pulse of healthcare, their practitioners, and they will provide us with information that will assist us do a better job in becoming excellent healthcare professionals who are knowledgeable about the diversity of the communities in which our patients come from. We hope that the course will stimulate discussion. That's one of the goals of our activities. And that these discussions will promote interest, cross-cultural interest in medicine and healthcare among you all. You can learn from the speakers as much as you learn from just sharing and talking among yourselves. And we hope that this course helps to create a culturally diverse and supportive learning environment at UCI for students, visitors, and the community. The focus points, awareness of all these issues, attitudes that change just because you'll hear the discussion, and the behavior that exemplifies having that knowledge and background that you'll take with you in public health and clinical practice, and also communication skills. Many of the student coordinators hone their skills through this course. We provide workshops that allow everybody to be able to come up and speak about their passion on any of these topics. You don't have to be on the podium to express that passion. That's why I encouraged all of the different representatives of the majors to speak. We also expect that you write. So for the graduate students, it will be a weekly activity and a major writing at the end of the quarter. For all of you, all of the undergraduate students, you'd have to write about one of these topics also at the end of the quarter. And we expect that verbal and oral communication is one of the ways that you express this knowledge of being sensitive to the diversity issues. So just very briefly, the undergraduate course, PH91, it's 2 units, pass, no pass. Attendance, 8 out of 10 lectures. You know, people do get sick or, you know, circumstances, act of God, we call it, where you can't be here. The real goal is that we don't have to chase you to be here, that you're here because you're interested in these topics, and you really want to hear the speakers. So if you're late, it disrupts the flow of the presentations. 2 latenesses is equivalent to 1 absence, and arriving 15 minutes late or leaving 15 minutes early is the penalty. That's not why we have the coordinators, but you saw that there are so many of them, they'll know if you do this. And then we hope that you will complete the surveys after the lectures that you attend to help us understand what we could do better with each speaker. And please do this within 3 days of attending the lecture so that you can get credit for it and that the memory is fresh. The grading is also based on completion of the course evaluation form at the end of the quarter, and that you submit this reflective course summary in the Dropbox at the end of the quarter. It's 1,000 words. On one of the presentations, whichever one you felt really engaged you, you felt moved by it, it's inspiring, write an article, an essay on that topic with references that are not included in 1,000 words. So you can find an article in a scholarly journal or a news report of some recent event that happened to support your essay. For the graduate students, it's 4 units. This quarter, it's also satisfactory or unsatisfactory. We will work on a letter grade option, but the grading will be 40% based on weekly summary reports. Again, I prefer that these are scholarly articles on the topic. So for next week's topic, which is mental health, this week you would find a scholarly journal article on the topic that addresses disparity issues, diversity, themes that are relevant to the course. Write a summary, 1 to 2 pages, drop the summary and the article that you read into the Dropbox, preferably no later than Monday so that everybody else can see what you've found. And then we'll meet at the end of the presentation to discuss the speaker's presentation and what you found in the literature. I'm hoping I sent an email to everybody to tell me what time they would prefer. I've been counting the ballot, so to speak, and right after class seems to be the ideal time that works for everybody, but we'll have another round of discussion to make sure everybody is comfortable with that time. But it will make a lot of sense so that we would all do our literature search on that topic, listen to the lecture, and then stay a little longer to discuss those papers that you have found. For the medical school elective course, to get a notation on your transcript, you have to attend 8 out of 10 lectures. It's optional, however, to submit the weekly course evaluations, but we would really encourage you to do so. I think at this point I will turn it over to the coordinators. Thank you.
Thank you, Deli. I know that it's a little bit past time, and I apologize for that, but are the websites below as well as the EEE websites? And I know that the directors and the coordinators will all be here a little bit after class, so if you guys have any more questions that you'd like to talk to us about, we're all here and willing to answer them. So thank you all for coming. And next week's lecture will be on mental health, specifically on schizophrenia, and it'll be by Dr. Clifton Schirmerhorn. So I hope to see you all there, and thank you all for coming again. I look forward to seeing you.